Welcome back to the Microsoft Private Cloud Jumpstart, creating and managing a private cloud with System Center 2012. I'm Simon Perriman, and I'm joined on this next module with Kenan, and we're really going to focus on the infrastructure components, thinking about how can we use the hardware, whether it's our storage, our networking, our computational power, or our memory, and prepare it to be used in a private cloud environment. Kenan, why don't you introduce yourself?
Thank you, Simon. My name is Kenan Owens, and I am a Senior Product Marketing Manager here at Microsoft, focusing on the infrastructure components of the private cloud, working on the System Center team. So really what I'm focusing on is taking that underlying physical fabric and converting it into something that we can use for the private cloud, but also taking and monitoring that stuff, and we'll talk about that later on. But for today, we're going to talk about the infrastructure components and what that means on the physical infrastructure.
So as we look where we are in the schedule, we're on our second module with Kenan, and we're really going to focus today on configuring and deploying. So how do we set it up? How do we prepare it? How do we really get it ready to be used in this private cloud environment? Now, I've already heard a few questions about what is the difference between infrastructure components and private cloud infrastructure?
Sure. Really quickly, infrastructure components are managing that physical layer, the actual physical devices, your CPU, your network, your storage. When you start to take that and aggregate it together to build something that can be more for private cloud and pull it all together, that's the private cloud infrastructure. So really, infrastructure components is a physical aspect. Private cloud infrastructure is when we abstract that to be used for private cloud.
So optimize it, use it in the concept of a private cloud.
Exactly.
That's great. Well, we're going to cover two modules on infrastructure component with a break in between. Then later in the day, we're going to be looking at service automation and delivery. So how do we really tie together these underlying hardware resources and what our end user application owner needs? And then we're going to wrap up the end of the day by looking at application management. So for our end user, how can they go and make a self-service request to get an application? How can they monitor the application? And then what happens under the covers from when they make the request to they get hardware provisioned and then get their resources back? So Kenan, why don't you give us an overview of the agenda for this particular module?
Excellent. So today we're going to talk about, in the infrastructure components section, really how do we configure and deploy those components? How do we ensure that the compute resources are ready to be used? Because everybody knows a lot of the things for private cloud is based on virtualization. So how do I get that virtualization layer up and running, ready to go? Then once it's up and ready to go, how do I attach storage to it? How do I manage the networking environments that we have? And then once I have all that together, bring it all together into a cluster and use that cluster to basically be the infrastructure for your private cloud. So we're going to go through each of those different components, show you a lot of demos on how we manage these things with System Center 2012, and really get you grounded in how do I manage these infrastructure components for a private cloud.
Well, you brought up a concept which I've actually seen a few questions on already. Mm-hmm. Virtualization and the private cloud. What's the difference? And is virtualization the same thing as a private cloud?
Virtualization is not exactly the private cloud. Virtualization is taking your underlying infrastructure, creating a virtualization environment, and simply running virtual machines. That is, you know, what a lot of what we're talking about in the infrastructure components and then the private cloud infrastructure is what a lot of people call straight virtualization. But when you add on the service delivery and automation, when you add on the application performance and management, and then when you start monitoring it and keeping it going throughout the lifecycle of the hardware and the applications, that's when you really turn it into a private cloud. If you're just creating a machine and putting virtualization on it, you're just doing virtualization. But when you can build the operational gains, the savings in time and effort when you build in service delivery and automation, when you build in the application performance management, that's when you really get the private cloud.
So virtualization is a critical piece of the private cloud.
Absolutely.
The private cloud is a lot more than just virtualization.
Exactly, exactly. It's not just the physical and the virtual environments, but it's the processes around it. All right, so we talked a lot about this earlier on in the sessions about where System Center helps provide these capabilities. And what we're going to focus on today is this configure and deploy in the infrastructure management point. So everything on the right-hand side, getting that physical infrastructure up and running, putting that physical infrastructure together, and building a private cloud with it. And in this session today, right now, we're going to talk about configuring and deploying that infrastructure. It's going to mainly focus on this virtual machine manager component of System Center 2012. And we'll show you all the cool things that we've added there that allow you to really build and manage the underlying infrastructure components. So you remember this slide we talked about earlier. We're really focusing on the building the productive infrastructure and building the cloud in your time, in your effort, the way you want to do it. So if we look at what is a private cloud, we have all these different pieces of infrastructure components. We have the physical servers, and inside those physical servers, there could be many different types of physical servers. It could be your Intel servers, your AMD, your HP, your Dell, your IBM. They could be different hypervisors installed on them, Microsoft, VMware, Citrix. You also have all these different types of storage. I may have iSCSI storage, fiber channel storage, may have fast disks, may have a bunch of slow disks, but just a lot of them. And I also have complex networking. Or I may just have simple networking, but I have a lot of different networking environments. And all these things get confusing for an organization when they're, or for the end users when they're trying to build their clouds and deploy services. They just want to deploy. They don't care what it actually goes on for the most part. So what we're doing in this session right here, talking about today, but what we're doing in this environment is taking that diverse infrastructure and building this logical and standardized environment by first carving out the different pieces of that physical resources and pulling them together and creating these logical and standardized units that we can then deliver up to create this cloud abstraction. So during this session and the session on the private cloud infrastructure, we're going to talk about these different pieces. After we take this private cloud abstraction, we're going to delegate out aspects of it or pieces of it to the different individual users or groups of users that need to use it. And what this means is that I can give pieces of this infrastructure to those people without having to worry that they're going to steal resources from someone else. I can delegate that capacity, and after I have this delegated capacity, I can deploy standardized services onto these environments. Once they're deployed on there, they can continue to run, and I can start, stop, migrate them around, do what needs to be done to ensure that they get the resources that they need. But pulling all this stuff together is what really this session and the next session are going to talk about. So we're focusing on how do I take these physical resources and combine them in such a way that I can create a private cloud? Well, first of all, I got to deploy and manage my compute resources. So the compute resources are taking a physical machine. Let's say I got a brand new blade or something like that. I can take that machine, plug it into the chassis, and then I want to deploy an OS on there. I want to enable it for virtualization. I want to get that machine up and running and being brought under management, and I want to do it in a simple way. So we're allowing you to do that through the fabric management that we have for compute within Virtual Machine Manager component of System Center 2012. But also you're going to have to manage the storage environment. And we're not saying replace your storage management tools that are out there, but instead take pieces of storage, allocate them to your management tools here and allow them to allocate them to the proper servers as they need them for using the storage that they have. Also, taking that networking environment, you have many different VLANs out there. You have many different switches and different confusing sets up of your network. And being able to simplify all that and abstract that complexity and pull it up into something that your self-service users could easily use to deploy services from themselves. And take all those things, bring them all together, and build the private cloud infrastructure by clustering these things and building that robust environment for your cloud. So that's what we're going to step through in these sessions, and we're going to start off by talking about your compute resources. One of the things we do within System Center 2012 is allow you to manage the compute resources that you have, whether it be physical servers that you're going to deploy OSs to, or you're going to manage those virtual hypervisors that you're going to be accessing. And we do that through System Center tools, both Configuration Manager component and the Virtual Machine Manager component. And whether I have physical servers that I need to deploy, because in some environments, maybe I have a SQL server or something like that, that SQL server needs to be able to, I got to take a brand new server and put it in there. I got to deploy it and configure it. And we'll use tools like Configuration Manager to set that up. but I also may have virtual machines that I need to deploy or physical servers that are going to be housing virtual machines, like my Hyper-V type servers. And for there, I can do bare metal deployment of those physical servers for Hyper-V. And I can do that with the Virtual Machine Manager component. So all now within one tool, I can do both my virtual physical machine management all the way up through my virtual machine management. And then after I do all that, I need to manage my virtualized environments, whether they be virtual machines on VMware or Citrix, and I can do all that from within the Virtual Machine Manager component.
Yeah, I just want to emphasize, you know, in the past with current system set of products, if you wanted to go create a cluster, you'd have to go create that cluster and fail over cluster manager.
Exactly.
Today, you'd have to go validate it, you know, run the test, make sure all the hardware is supported. With VMM 2012, we've put all of this into the single product, into the single component, straight into VMM. So now from VMM, you can create the cluster, manage the cluster, deploy it, validate it. So you could literally go from the bare metal all the way up to a running clustered host using a single tool, a single utility, a single interface. So again, just simplifying the process. Fewer screens, fewer tools that you need to learn.
Exactly, and you basically just stole my thunder for the whole presentation. Thanks a lot, Simon. But seriously, I mean, that is the key, is that we want to bring that all together into one common tool set so you don't have to go to all these different places to configure things and set them up. And once we've configured or provisioned that infrastructure, we can then have this platform for running your virtual machines. So one of the ways we do that is with bare metal deployment through Virtual Machine Manager. And why would I want to do that? Well, I can take a brand new physical machine, plug it in, rack it, stack it, connect to it, deploy an OS to it, enable it for Hyper-V, connect all the right storage and everything to it from within one tool. This means that I can ensure that the OSs I'm deploying are going to be on approved OS configurations. I can keep track of the OSs that I'm going to use, and I can update them. When I deploy new servers, it's always going to have that updated build, which is always a safe thing to do. And then lastly, I can automate the configuration of and deployment of one, two, or hundreds of servers as I need to deploy them on this environment. We have some customers where they actually have taken, basically as they get new servers in, they can deploy these things out, and they said that using now VMM 2012, they can get it in about half the time that they were able to do it before because they can do it all from one centralized location.
So real quickly, what are some of the automation tools that are provided in VMM?
So for bare metal deployment of servers, we have the ability to connect to, and I'll show you this in the demo, but via different protocols like IPMI or SMASH, we can connect to the bare metal controllers and deploy the servers. And through the process of deploying the servers, we have a lot of automated steps. And I'll go through that in the next slide here that kind of goes through each of the different steps that we take. Besides that, we also do things which I'll talk about in future sessions where we can automate the updating of these clusters and do it in an orchestrated fashion. So there's a lot of new automation capabilities built into VMM. But if there are things that you need to do that aren't necessarily automated in VMM, you can always use tools like Orchestrator to orchestrate and automate those things.
And of course, the whole system set suite is built on top of PowerShell, or VMM is built on top of PowerShell. So if you've done a tool once, you've gone through a series of wizards, there'll actually be a nice little button that says View Script, and you get that full PowerShell printout. So if you've deployed a cluster, let's say, you want to go and deploy 50 more, you could just go and run this PowerShell script again and again. So a lot of automation built into it, because remember, automation is one of these key tenets of private cloud. And so with VMM, things such as these new protocols, PowerShell, System Center Orchestrator, we've really enhanced the ability and given a lot of options for how you can go and automate these deployments.
Exactly. And that's one of the beauties that I really like about VMM, is that I can create these customized scripts that allow me to do the tasks that I need to do over and over again without having to go through a GUI every time I want to do things like deploy a VM, deploy a service, bare metal deploy a physical server. So if we look at what does bare metal deployment mean and what are the steps that we go through within Virtual Machine Manager to do that, we basically do the deployment of a machine in 9 easy steps. Let's see, the first one is once we've figured out which server we're going to restart, we take the VMM server and we connect to that server through the baseboard management controller, your HP ILO, your Dell DRAC, those types of things, and we tell it to reboot. When it reboots, it goes and it does a pixie boot. At that pixie boot, it connects to one of your WDS servers. That server will download, authorize that machine for pixie. It will download the WinPE image down to that server. The server will boot up, and at that point, we'll be in a pre-configured environment. From there, we'll run through any generic command execution scripts we have to do, format the hard drive, any of those necessary tools to get this machine up and ready to have an OS deployed onto it. Once we finish those, the next thing we do is we communicate directly with one of the library servers that VMM has. And within that library server, we're going to download the VHD, which is going to be the OS image of this booted server. So we're going to take a pre-existing VHD, and a lot of customers basically just use the VHD file that they're using for deploying VMs. They can use something very similar, if not the same one, to deploy the OS down in the machine. After we download the VHD, we will take that machine and we'll inject any special drivers. If it's an HP system, it may need a special driver for the NIC cards or for the array or something like that. We'll download all those things. If it's connected to fiber channel storage, you probably want to download the drivers for the fiber channel adapter, those types of things. And also, we can run any custom scripts there. After we've customized that machine there, we'll domain join it. And once it's domain joined, it will enable the Hyper-V role at that point, reboot the machine, and it's now a member of whatever host group you wanted to put it in.
So a question, when you say that we join the active domain automatically, how do we do that from a security perspective? Do we need to pre-allocate credentials inside Virtual Machine Manager so it knows how it joins, or is there another mechanism?
We do. What we do is we create these things called run-as accounts. And a run-as account allows me to insert, say, a domain admin account or someone who's authorized to add a machine to a domain. And when I set up this machine, I will actually connect that machine with the run-as account. When it boots up, it'll use that run-as account to connect to the domain controller to add itself to the domain.
So there's no additional prompt saying, you know, what is the username, account name, password, anything like that?
Exactly. I wouldn't have to type that in. Or the other option is that I could create in the configuration and hard code some of those things in the hardware profile. And we'll explore that a little bit in a few minutes as well.
Great. Now take it a step back as well. You refer to the VMM server. Sorry, the VMM library server.
Sure.
Can you just give a brief overview of what exactly the role of that library server is for those that might not be familiar with VMM?
Great. So VMM is a server application that the component of System Center 2012 that has a few different pieces to it. They can all be run on the same VMM server, or I could split them out. And two of the aspects are the VMM server itself, which manages all the different virtual machine environments and is the central repository, the thing that you connect to and do things with. And then there is the library, and the library is where it stores things like virtual machine templates, service templates, VHD files, custom scripts, server application virtualization, apps, MS deploy packages, all these different pieces. Now that library can be on the same box or can be on different boxes, and I can replicate that to different areas because maybe I have data centers in multiple locations and I want to download from the local data center instead of across the wire. So I can replicate the library server over to the other site as well. I'll show you a little bit of this when we move into the demo right now, because what I want to do is kind of give you a little brief view of what VMM is, and then we'll go into doing a bare metal deployment and show you what that looks like.
Okay, that sounds great. So tell me, in this demo, what exactly are all the different components that you're going to show? Is it just VMM in this demo?
In this particular demo, I'm just showing the VMM component of System Center 2012, yeah. So let me switch over here to the demo. And what we're going to see here within this demo screen right here is VMM 2012. So this is the Virtual Machine Manager component of System Center 2012. It has multiple different areas. And what you'll see is that you have the ability to look at your VMs and your services that are deployed. And if you're familiar with VMM 2008, this is this is going to look very different. And it's going to look different because of a couple of things. One of them, as you can see, we now have this context ribbon up top. So you'll be able to pick any type of special task that you want to do that are contextual with whatever you're clicked on. The other thing is you're going to see on the left here, not only do we see VMs, but we see this, or hosts, like you would be familiar with 2008, but you also see these things called clouds. And we're going to talk about clouds in the private cloud infrastructure talk, but really it's just a way of taking those physical resources and abstracting them and collecting them together into something that we can now delegate out to individual users. Inside those clouds, we see that we have this thing called a service running. And a service isn't just one VM. It's a collection of virtual machines. And those virtual machines allow you to do things at a multi-virtual machine level instead of just at a single virtual machine. And inside of there, you have different tiers of your service, and those tiers have one or more virtual machines attached to them. So we have the VMs and services section. We also have the workspace for the fabric. And the fabric workspace is where we're going to focus most of our talk today. And the fabric is where we're going to focus on managing the servers, the storage, and the networking. So I'll go into that in a few minutes. We'll skip down to the library. The library is what we talked about before, where I have these different templates. I have service templates. I have VM templates. I also have these different profiles. And the profiles are sets of information regarding things like, on a hardware profile, I'm looking at what's the hardware of the virtual machine is going to look like. The one we're going to focus on right now in this session is the host profile. And that host profile is the configuration, that makeup of what that physical machine is going to look like when I deploy down to it. We also have a lot of other things like inside the cloud libraries, we have our inside the library servers, we have different things like virtual disks, SQL DAC packets, and SQL scripts, and all the different types of information I need to deploy these new services and applications. So you had a question?
Yeah, I have a question. Great question here. What about Microsoft Deployment Toolkit? Does this work with System Center?
We work with the WDS server, and I believe we use the Microsoft Deployment Toolkit. You can use that to create the pre-created VHD file that we're going to use to deploy mm-hmm. down to images, but we don't call it directly.
Okay,
we go through the WDS server.
So technically it will work, but there'll be a intermediary that sits there that you have to work through to go and deploy this.
Right. As far as I know about Microsoft Deployment Toolkit, yeah, that's how it would work. So within the VMM environment, we're talking about the server management. And in the server management, we have the ability to look at the different hosts that we have deployed. And we do them through these things called host groups. And if we look at this environment right here, I have multiple host groups. I have an administrative infrastructure host group, a couple of other host groups, and each of these host groups can have your hypervisors. And those hypervisors can be of different types. I can have just standalone Hyper-V servers, I can have ESX servers, and I can have Hyper-V clusters, and I could have Citrix Zen servers and clusters as well inside of these host groups. These host groups allow me to organize how these hypervisors are stored, and I can set certain policies at the host group level, which we'll talk about in the monitor and operate section of the talk. But for this example right here, I want to do a bare metal deployment, and it's as easy as clicking on a few buttons here. First of all, click Add Resources, pick Hyper-V Hosts and Clusters. If I had a server that was already existing that I just wanted to add in and bring into management from VMM, I would pick a Windows Server in a trusted domain or untrusted or perimeter network. But I want to do a bare metal deployment of a physical server. So I'm going to pick a physical computer to be provisioned. At this point, I'm going to use that run as account. So we were talking about a run as account. This run as account here is the run as account I would use to connect into the bare metal controller, the baseboard management controller, the ILO machine, the Dell Drac, whatever you know that out of band management machine is. So I'm going to use this account here for that. And here's where I can choose which protocol to use, whether it be IPMI or SMASH, or if the hardware vendor has created their own custom provider, we can install and use one of those. And I'm going to use a custom provider here for this installation. At this point, I'll choose the range of IP addresses or the specific IP address. If I wanted to deploy four or five of them, I could pick a bunch here. So I'm going to pick the range for the IP for the baseboard management controller that I know is in this address range. So between 201 and 205. And at this point, we go out and we ping all the different baseboard management controllers out there. And the ones that give us a response back, that say, hey, yeah, we can talk through this provider, we're going to see. And if I don't see the one that I want to use, I can hit refresh until they all show up. And right here, I see that I'm looking for number 2 here. So 2 is available. I'm going to pick it. If I want to, I could also pick multiple servers and choose them. So I'm going to pick 202. I'm going to pick 201 here to deploy, and I'll hit next. I choose which host group I want to deploy this thing in. So I can specify multiple different host groups depending on where I want to deploy the server. And I'm going to deploy it in the administrative infrastructure group. At this point, I can specify whether I wanted to use DHCP or a static IP. And I'm going to choose static IP. At this point, a Contoso brand PC is the PC that I wanted to use. And I'm going to pick from there. I choose now to fill in all the different settings I want. So the first thing I want to do is call this one ConHSV01. And I need to type in the MAC address of this machine. Fortunately, I know what the MAC address was. I'll just type it in real quick here. And at that point, I can choose what network it's going to be connected to, and I would just need to specify the IP address I want to give to that machine.
Now, as I see you typing in these IP addresses, does System Center 2012 support DHCP? If you have a DHCP in your environment, you know, is there any benefits from automatically getting an IP address rather than, you know, hard coding these in?
We'll talk about that in the next section, but really within the within VMM, we do a lot with networking. We understand that your networking could be hard-coded, could be DHCP. We also understand that you may want to have a pool of IP addresses, but you want each of the VMs or the physical machines to be statically assigned an address. So we can take this pool, and as we deploy VMs or physical hosts, statically give them an IP address from that pool. So we have a lot of different options for you when you do that. And then I hit next, and at that point hit finish, and it will start to connect to the server and deploy the OS. So at this point, it's connecting to the baseboard management controller of that server, rebooting it, and starting the deployment process. If I look here, I can see that it's added that machine into the node, and we're in the status of deploying, so it's going to go through the steps to do that. If we look at the jobs, we can see that we're at a create host from physical machine. The job is starting, and it's working on booting the machine, deploying the OS, and everything down to it. So that is how we do hardware deployment, bare metal deployment of a machine to get a Hyper-V system on there. And yeah, we only do that with VMM for Hyper-V hosts, but we can do that bare metal deployment for your Hyper-V servers within VMM itself. So now let me switch back to the presentation.
Now, I have a question that's coming while you're switching back here.
Sure.
How does VMM talk with other data center management products, such as BMC?
So VMM would manage the virtual machine environment, and we have connectors to other system center tools, like a connector for service manager and a connector for operations manager. If you want to communicate with other third-party type applications, the best way to do that is orchestrated through Orchestrator,
okay,
where it has connections to there, and it can take information from one place and move it to the other and run all the commands that we would run, you know, through the GUI with VMM, but it could do it through PowerShell and the integration packs.
So BMC will have an integration pack, VMM will have an integration pack. Using Orchestrator, you could piece a workflow
together.
You
could build a workflow together, right. There's nothing out of the box that I know of, but you can build those things together.
Excellent.
All right, so we talked about the compute storage, and that's going to take a while. It's got to throw the OS down. It's got to do all the configuration and everything for it. So it's going to take a while to deploy that thing. Probably it's going to take a little longer than we have in this session today. But after you've done the OS deployment, you also want to configure and manage the storage environment. And in the storage environment, it's not that you're going to be managing LUNs and you're going to be doing carving out from a physical hard disk and creating a bunch of LUNs or anything from the pool. But what you're really going to want to do is alleviate that need to go back to the storage guy every time you need different pieces of storage. So what we do within VMM 2012 component of System Center is we allow you to utilize that storage much more efficiently. We give you what we call end-to-end mapping. Not only can I see from the VM point of view what physical machine is connected to, and that physical machine sees the storage device is connected to and the LUN that it's connected on, but also if I looked at it the other way and looked at the storage device, I could see all the way through to what VHDs were running on top of there, whether it's a dedicated LUN or a CSV. It also gives me the ability to manage my capacity and what types of users can access which pieces of storage. I may have, you know, really expensive storage that's really fast and great for SQL servers, but I don't want to deploy my web servers on there because it's just, it's using up my high-end storage for something that could run very well on maybe a tier 2 or tier 3 type storage. So what we allow you to do is classify your different pieces of storage, and by classifying them, you can assign different virtual machines to only deploy on different types or tiers of storage. And then we allow for things like rapid provisioning. If I have a VM that's on a LUN and I want to create thousands of them, I could just replicate that LUN many times and create multiple different virtual machines, attach them into VMM, and attach them to my different clusters and go off and run those virtual machines. So we have a lot of different ways using the standard SMIS protocols to manage and help alleviate your need to always be going asking for more storage. You can get pools of storage and assign them. And how it works is like this. Through Virtual Machine Manager, I may have multiple different host groups, and inside those host groups, I have different physical servers. Within Virtual Machine Manager, we connect through the SMIS provider, and through that provider, discover the different storage that's out there. And as you see here, I have basically two different types of storage. The storage on the left, the green and orange, is say a tier one type storage that has a pool of storage resources that I'm going to assign to VMM, but also a LUN that's already been created. The blue storage, maybe it's the same storage at two different locations, or maybe it's the same storage vendor, but it's multiple different pieces or pools of storage that I want to classify with different versions. So I can create storage classification pools, maybe call one tier one or high I/O and one tier two, or maybe, you know, secondary I/O or low I/O. And from each of those pools, as you can see, I could have different storage types inside of the same tier. I just want to classify it as this kind of storage is this tier, and this aspect of the storage is this other tier. I can take those different tiers and assign them to specific host groups that I have. And by assigning to a host groups, now I can actually allocate or assign the storage that's available if it's an existing LUN, or create new LUNs and attach them to different hosts. So I can take that existing LUN and attach it to that cluster of hosts right there, or I can create a brand new LUN, and then once I've created that LUN, attach it to that existing host. And what this allows me to do now is create the LUNs and manage the LUNs as I need them for the different hosts. We take care of, through the SMIS provider, the masking and unmasking of LUNs. So in other words, if I had, say, a two-node cluster and I wanted to add a third node to it, well, that third node needs to access the same storage that the first nodes did. So what we'll do is when we add that node to the cluster, we will assign those LUNs that are already in max to that cluster to that new machine as we add it in. And if we removed it, we will unassign those LUNs to that machine.
And as far as you know, what types of LUNs we use? I know you touched on this before already, but can you just repeat, you know, we support what, fiber channel, we support iSCSI, so we serial support, attached SCSI, fiber channel over Ethernet?
So we support fiber channel and iSCSI, communication through the SMIS protocol. So how that all works, if you have the right drivers for fiber channel over Ethernet and those types of things, that'll just work. We support everything that Hyper-V supports for connecting to storage. The other thing is that we support both your regular LUNs that are maybe a dedicated LUN assigned to a cluster, or your CSV volumes. We support both of those as well when we create these clustered environments.
Excellent. And I'm actually just going to address a question that I've seen a lot of. It's regarding storage features that have been announced for the next version of Windows Server, things such as storage live migration. Just to be clear, at this point, we're not going to be speaking about Windows Server futures. We're just going to be focused on System Center 2012 and current capabilities that it has. So in the future, System Center 2012 will certainly be supporting Windows 8, but at this time, we're just focusing on System Center 2012 with Windows Server 2008 R2.
Exactly. So let's move over now to a demo and show you a little bit about the storage management and how that works.
So again, what are you going to? Which technologies or which components are you going to be showing us in this demo?
So for all the demos and the rest of the demos for this session here, it's all going to be under VMM, or Virtual Machine Manager component. Where we're going to show more of the other components will be in the monitor and operate discussions.
Great.
So in this environment, if we look at under the Fabric workspace, if we look at the different options we have here, we have the ability to look at providers. And the provider is the SMIS provider for that particular storage. In this environment here, I'm connecting to a physical machine, and that machine is what's running the SMIS provider. Some storage vendors have the SMIS provider inside their controllers themselves, so it really depends on the storage that you have, but you'll get the provider from, you'll download or set up your provider outside of VMM, and then you'll add a new provider through VMM simply by, if you wanted to add a new provider, you could just right-click and do an add storage devices and add that provider in there. Well, I've already have this provider added inside there. I already have an array created. So I have this FAS 3070, and I'm already managing some of the pools of storage that are within there. So if I right-click on the machine and look at properties, we can see that it has multiple aggregates. An aggregate in a NetApp environment is a pool of storage that you put LUNs and volumes on. And inside of here, aggregates 2, 3, and 4, I've allocated so that VMM can manage those. I don't want it to do my aggregate 1 or my aggregate 0, but I'm doing just the ones that are already there. And I've already assigned them classifications as far as primary or secondary storage. And if I wanted to, I could create a brand new classification, give it my name. And what classifications do is they show you inside of the classification and pools what storage pools are available in there and what they're actually doing. So I have a primary storage, and inside there I have an aggregate. And inside that aggregate, I have a few logical units that I've already created, a few LUNs I've carved out. And some of them have been assigned to physical hosts and some haven't. I also have in my secondary storage multiple aggregates as well. And some of these have logical units that are created and some aren't. Where I need to use this is that I need to dedicate resources to particular hosts or host groups. So once I've created these classifications and assigned pools of storage into these classifications, I can now attach them to individual host groups. So if we look at those servers again that I have, and we look at the different host groups that I have here, I have this administrative infrastructure host group. If we look at the properties of it, this is where I would assign access to the storage. So in the storage environment here, I look at the different pools that I have connected, and I have one pool, aggregate 2, that's connected. Well, I want to add that other pool of storage, and these storage pieces are available, so I'm going to add aggregate 4 as well to this pool. So now I have multiple pools of storage available. If I wanted to allocate particular LUNs, I could, if I had any that are created, I can allocate them there. If I don't have any created, I can create them myself, and I'll show you how to do that. So I've allocated multiple aggregates to the pool. Now what I want to do is create a new logical unit. I can simply hit create logical unit, pick the aggregate I'm going to use, and I'll pick aggregate 3 because I'll pick 3 because it has some resources available. And I'll say VM hold, give it the name that, and we'll allocate, in this example, we'll allocate 20 gigs of storage. Yeah, it's not going to hold too many VMs, but it'll show you what I actually need to do with it. And like Simon said, everything we do has VueScript capability. So for this one, I only have a couple of lines here of what I need to do. I need to get the storage pool, and then I need to create a new LUN on that storage pool. So I can just take those commands, and then if I want to do this over and over and over again, create 100 LUNs, I could run the script multiple times by just simply cutting this out, pasting it in, and just running that. So I have that ability inside of VMM. For anything that VMM does, I can create a script and do PowerShell to do it.
Yeah, I just really want to emphasize that point. I've seen a lot of questions about, can I do this in PowerShell? The answer is yes, VMM is built on top of PowerShell. Anything that you can do in the graphical user interface, you can also script with PowerShell. So just because we're not showing it, don't think that that means it's not possible. It just doesn't make a very attractive demo. But everything that you're seeing here, absolutely fully supported, scriptable, and automatable using PowerShell.
So once I've created that pool, that LUN, now I can allocate that LUN to this host group if I wanted to. And as we see here, I went back into the properties of the host group to the storage tab, allocate logical units, and I see there's that new storage that I created called VM hold, and I can add that. As you can see, there are already a couple of storage pools available within this pool as well. A couple of lines that have already been created. And those are actually assigned to a cluster. So we'll show you a little bit about that as well. So I hit OK. And at that point, I have some storage that now can be allocated to individual hosts. So if I look at one of these hosts, and I have this failover cluster here, and if we look at cluster node 1 here, and I look at the properties of that cluster node, this is the actual physical Hyper-V server. I can look at the storage available to it, and it sees that I have a connection to the FAS array, the iSCSI storage. And to add that, all I did was simply click Add here, and it was able to add a connection. So if I had multiple iSCSI or Fibre Channel connections, I wanted to add a connection, I would just hit Add at this point and create a new connection to it. The other thing I can do is that I want to show you that in cluster node 3, which is not a part of this failover the existing failover cluster, if I look under storage, I have access to the FAS server, so I have the session, but I don't have access, if we look at the hardware under the storage, I don't have access to any of the LUNs. One thing I wanted to show you real quickly here, under the first storage, I do have access to those existing LUNs. See, I have those two E and F are those two extra LUNs that I had created, and those are my cluster LUNs for deploying virtual machines and such. So I'm showing you that now because what we're going to do later on when I add this node to the cluster is you're going to see it automatically mask the LUNs to be available for this cluster machine. All right, so that shows you a lot of the different things I can do with storage. We'll show you a little bit later how it masks and unmasks the storage and those types of things. But it really gives you a lot of information, a lot of ability to manage the storage independently of the underlying physical machines.
All right.
All right, next I'm going to now move into the ability to manage the networking part of your environment. And here we're going to talk about how do I logically abstract that complex networking and build it into something that my self-service users can use very easily.
And so what networking components can we really manage? Is it just the switch, or are we extending to things such as load balancers as well?
So in this environment, we're not actually doing anything on the switch. We're just taking that underlying physical resources that are created, and we're simplifying it from what it looks like today. So we'll talk about in the monitor and operate, where we can do a little bit more with the switches as far as monitoring them, where we will be physically touching the switch. Here, we're taking your underlying existing switch environment, and we're just abstracting it and surfacing it up into something that's a lot more simple to view.
Great.
All right, so in the switch environment, in the network management we do within the virtual machine management component of System Center 2012, what we really are focusing on is creating these things called logical networks. Logical network is a simplistic way of taking all your different IP address scheme and VLAN information and putting it into something that's a lot more palatable for a self-service type user, where instead of saying this IP range with this VLAN, just say production network. And when we pick production network, depending on where it gets deployed, it'll choose the right IP stuff. We're able to create these things called address pools. We can do it for IP addresses, for MAC addresses. We can create these IP address pools so that we can allocate static IPs to VMs or hosts without having to physically type in what IP address we're going to use. It'll just take it from a pool of resources, but create a static IP on the VM. Then we'll also manage and connect with load balancers. And for load balancer support, through a provider, we'll connect to that load balancer. When we deploy, say, a service that has multiple VMs and a web front end, when we want to connect to, say, an F5 or some other Brocade or Citrix load balancer, we can connect right into that load balancer, add the member servers, and create that virtual IP and connect them together and pick the right load balancing mechanism or scheme for that deployment. So within logical networking, think of it this way. I have this, as the slide was you've seen before, I have this diverse infrastructure. And I have, say, maybe complex networking where I have multiple data centers and both of them want to use something very similar, or maybe I have a development environment and that environment just wants has one switch, but I want it to emulate multiple different networks. So I can create this logical network for things like, say, my DMZ or my production environment. And whether I have a complex or simple networking, I can assign them to the appropriate physical servers. Once I've done that, then when I create the clouds and deploy the services, those services, whether they're connected to the simple network environment, that service has a network configuration that says, I need these VMs to talk to this network, these VMs to talk to this network. I can build all of that into the service template, and no matter where I deploy it, it'll deploy to the correct servers and to the correct networking and build that correct networking configuration, right IP addresses, VLANs, by what host it deploys on, which network it's attached to. So we do that by creating these things called IP pools within the logical network environment. So these IP pools allow me to create a pool of IP addresses that we can deploy, we can allocate on deployment of VMs, and we can return on any of the VM deletions. We can also do the same thing with MAC addresses. We can also, within those IP pools, create out virtual IP pools that allow me to manage my and connect to my virtual load balancers. So for load balancer support, we'll connect through the hardware provider. So from your F5, Brocade, Citrix, you'll get the load balancer provider, and we'll install that on the VMM machine, and then we'll be able to connect to the F5 or the Brocade or the Citrix NetScaler and allocate or assign the appropriate virtual IP information, configure the load balancing method, all those different things. The nice thing is I can assign these load balancers to different hosts or clusters, clouds. And when I assign them to clouds, what that means is that as I deploy a service and that service needs a load balancer, it'll pick the right one from that's been assigned to that cloud environment.
So again, more automation, less things that the administrator needs to think about, what's associated with which environment.
Exactly. You set it up first, you set it up initially, and then you can reuse it multiple times. So it lowers that operational cost afterwards of how to use these things. So let's show you what that looks like for network management inside of the private cloud.
So as we switch over to the demo here, once again, we're just showing VMM.
That's right.
That's right. And we're going to show some of the advanced network management now.
Exactly. So again, in the Fabric workspace, we now have this networking section. And here we have a couple of things that are important. And the first one is the logical networks. The logical networks allows me to specify different networks that I can then assign to my different virtual machine templates, assigned to my host, however I need to use them when I deploy applications or services. And I have a couple here. I have a Contoso logical network, and I have a development logical network. And so if the development logical network already has a specific IP pool set up for it, and this works great when I'm connected to servers that are connected to this IP range. What if I wanted to connect to a different set of servers and those had a different IP range for those network adapters? What I would do is I would just basically create a new network site. So if I look under the properties of this host group, I have this site called Redmond, and that's where I have this initial IP address. But I have another site over in Chicago. So let me add this here. We'll just name this Chicago. And it has a totally different subnet range. And I'm going to use the servers in the infrastructure 02 and the admin servers. So I can specify which host groups are in that area that I want to attach to. Insert a row. So the VLAN, if I had a specific VLAN ID, and this is a VLAN 29, and the different subnet range. So these would be 10. So I specify the IP address range here, and I hit OK. So at that point, I have now a different network site that is available for deploying different virtual machine addresses there. So I can create a new IP pool, and I'm going to call this Chicago Dev. I'll call it Dev Chicago. And inside that new IP pool, pick the logical network it's going to use. Choose the network site. Well, I have the Redmond or Chicago. I'm going to pick the Redmond or the Chicago site. And at this point, I can specify the IP range that I want to allocate. Now, I want to allocate the first 20 addresses for servers that I've already deployed, and everything's out there, so I don't want to use them. So I'm going to start at 21, and I want to go up to 200. So I have 180 IP addresses here. I can specify some IP addresses for virtual IPs and load balancers. So I will specify 170 to 179. So these 10 IP addresses are going to be IP addresses that I'll use for my virtual IP templates. If I wanted to and specify just all the numbers here, I could block out some other IP addresses at that point. Type in the different gateway information here. Any DNS information. The DNS suffix. So all the different information that I need for deploying an existing network environment. Once I've deployed all that information and set it up, I hit finish, and it's now going to create that second IP subnet. Now, when I deploy a service and I use the development logical network, whichever physical server it's going to deploy to, it'll then look at what the network environment is set up for that, and it'll deploy to that service. So I've created these different logical networks. To use them, I need to attach them to things. I'm going to show you later on how to attach them to a cloud, but right now, I want to attach them to particular hosts. So I have these different hosts here, like this con HSV03 host. And if I right-click on the properties of that host, we'll see that in the hardware, I have different networks. And inside each of those different networks that are available, I have the ability to specify which, for the different physical adapters that are available, which logical network I want to attach it to. And I'm going to attach the development network to the NIC here. And I just click it, and if I want to use it by management, I can click all that stuff too. If I wanted to get special and choose exactly which IP addresses it should use or shouldn't use, I can pick them in here. Because I'm using different VLANs, I'm going to have to pick, you know, trunk mode for the VLAN switch and everything like that. Well, I don't want it to use these IP addresses, so I'm just going to use the ones that are assigned. So I hit OK there, and now I have this machine available to use those development network and deploy virtual machines to it by using that. So that's how we set up the different networking environments. You can also manage your different load balancers and such, again, through the network fabric. We see that I have a couple of load balancers created. I have the network load balancing, which comes with VM in 2012, and I also have a provider that we've created here internally at Microsoft that I can use to emulate a load balancer. And there I basically have one that's created, and if I look at the properties here, I can see the different types of how it's setting up the networks, what it's trying to do as far as configuration, and any type of, you know, manufacturers and those types of things. All right, so I have the networking set up. I have it created. I've now fixed the storage. I've deployed the server. So the next step really is, let's go do a cluster. So let me flip back to the presentation, and we'll talk about the cluster aspects and what types of things we do inside of System Center 2012 in the configure and deploy a cluster.
Well, just before we wrap up the networks, I've seen a few questions here about using IPv6 versus using IPv4. Mm-hmm. What's the stance as far as is IPv6 supported with VMM 2012?
So we support IPv4 and IPv6. And when I deploy a virtual machine, when I create these IP pools, I can create them as IPv4 pools or IPv6 pools. And when I deploy a virtual machine, I have a choice of choosing, when you deploy an address, IPv4 only, IPv6 only, or both.
Excellent.
So
thanks.
I have all those choices. All right, so if we go back and we recap basically everything that we've done so far during the session today. The first thing we did was we configured some storage, or one of the things we did was configure some storage. Another thing we did was configure the networking, the logical networks and those types of things, the IP addresses. We've also done the bare metal deployment of the server. We've booted, we've installed it, we've configured it, and everything's up and running and ready to go. The next thing is to take those physical servers and just create a cluster out of those resources. And we simply do that by create Hyper-V cluster. When we do that, we run through a quick wizard, and what it does is basically say which physical storage do you want to attach to this cluster, which network devices, do you want to do cluster validation, do you want to skip it, which is only something that I recommend if you are doing it in a test environment. And then it'll go and create that cluster for you. It'll enable it'll enable the cluster feature if it's not enabled. After it's been set up, it will attach all the right storage to that environment, to those physical machines, and it'll create that cluster for you. It'll create all the proper quorum or witnessing disks that you need, and everything's set up and ready to go for this cluster. So the couple things to remember on that is that, one, it's all a wizard-based experience, all done through VMM. So I don't have to go out to Cluster Manager now and configure my storage. And so when I set up when I do the bare metal deployment of the host, things I want to do is make sure that I enable iSCSI if I'm going to use iSCSI's connection and MPIO at that point. Or if it's fiber channel, make sure the fiber channel adapters are all set up and ready to go. Again, enable MPIO. Once I do that, then it'll go through and zone the correct storage to the correct host and everything like that, provided you have that all set up correctly, and do your cluster for you. It'll take that logical network that you've created, and it'll assign it and make sure that a cluster network's set up across the entire cluster. So it'll do it on all the different machines for you. Things that you can do once this cluster is created: I can create a cluster, I can add and remove nodes from that cluster. When I add and remove a node, it will actually allocate and deallocate the storage to that node, so that I don't have to do all that beforehand. It just takes all that work for me. And then when I'm done with this cluster, if I want to decommission it, I can simply delete that cluster. And at that point, the cluster will become a standalone host, and all this shared storage will be returned to the managed storage pool. So what I'd want to do is make sure I move those VMs that I wanted to keep off of that cluster before I deleted the cluster.
And that's a great point. You know, as we think about private cloud, as we're creating resources, we also want to think about contracting resources. So when we're no longer using specific storage, the cluster's being destroyed, those VMs are no longer being used, we want to make sure we reallocate that back into the pool. And using VMM, we can handle all of that for you.
Exactly, exactly. It's all straightforward and right inside of the VMM UI itself. So when I'm creating a new cluster, you know, first thing it's going to want me to do is say, which host group do I want to use and which host do I want to cluster? So I specify the groups I want to cluster. I can skip validation, like I said. If I want to validate it later, I can definitely do that at any point in time. The other thing is that we handle the different networking addresses that you might have. So in this example here, I have an IP pool, and I've detected that this host is on that same IP pool, and I wanted to just take a static IP address from that IP pool and use that for the IP address of the cluster. The other thing is if it was a, I detected the logical network, but I wanted to manually assign that IP address, I could do that as well. And then lastly, if it's one that's not on an IP pool that are, or a logical network that I already have, I can either type in, I can type in a manual address there to access that IP pool, that IP range. So I can create these different cluster